Now on BBC Two, the interview we've been building up to this afternoon. A rare chance to meet the woman behind the sexy Hollywood image, Jane Russell, in conversation with Mark Cousins.
Thank you, gentlemen. That was a charming introduction.
I'm meeting a famous movie star today, and she's coming to my flat to talk about her career.
So we're going to do something that you haven't done much before, which is have your photograph taken.
Oh, that's shocking.
She did only 20 movies. The best were made between 1943 and 57, a time when the American film industry wanted to produce goddesses. In this woman, they produced a goddess. I read that when you were publicizing Outlaw, you had 2 years of photographs, 9 to 5 every day.
Yes.
It's unbelievable.
Just went out at 9 o'clock in the morning and we shot until the sun turned yellow.
But there's something contrasty about her. She astonishes you, but you want to have a beer with her. Men loved her, but women loved her too. They liked the way she expressed female desire.
It ain't the age, it's the attitude.
Okay, are you ready for a room full of photographers? And this star became bored of being what Mitchum called the girl in the piece.
Ladies and gentlemen, Jane, are you ready?
She wanted to work with women's directors such as George Cukor. She was one of the first actors to set up her own production company. She got involved with adoption policy and changed the law in America. She lived in the real world. This everyday goddess disappointed by movies. Here she is, Jane Russell.
We're just two little girls from Little Rock. We lived on the wrong side of the tracks. But the gentlemen friends who used to call, they never did seem to mind at all. They came to the wrong side of the tracks.
Is it true that your mum named you Jane Russell because she thought the names Jane and Russell would look good in lights?
Well, actually, I think she thought my name was going to be Ernestine Jane Geraldine Russell, but then she said the Jane Russell would look good in lights.
And it did?
It did.
She tread the boards in New York. She was an actress. You didn't have to do any of that. It's very different.
No, I was much too lazy. It's a good thing it happened the way it did. No, she was never a pushy mother at all.
You wouldn't have let yourself to be pushed around too much?
No, anyway. I was a very stubborn kid.
And your dad, it's your dad's family who have Scottish roots?
Yes, my mother and my father both have Scottish roots.
Uh-huh. Your father had a stroke when you were just 15, is that right?
Right.
How did that affect you?
Well, it was devastating. And my mother was left with 5 children. I was the oldest, and I had 4 younger brothers. And our lives changed completely. We lost the lovely couple that took care of us. I started doing the laundry and the ironing. My mother did the cooking, and she was never a very good cook, and I've never learned to cook.
Your husband said the other day you could burn water.
Burn water.
That was a very complimentary thing to say, wasn't it?
First thing I say to a man is, can you cook? Because if he can't, we can't go any further.
What a mercenary girl you are.
Scottish, you know.
And as far as I understand it, your mother had a miscarriage, and that in some way strengthened her religious belief, is that right?
No, it wasn't a miscarriage. She had a baby. I would have had an older brother. Uh-huh. And he was 15 months old. Uh-huh. And he'd gotten something in the yard. She never did find out, but she dug it out of his mouth and cleaned him up and brought him in. He had dinner and was on his grandfather's lap, and everything was fine. And he went to bed, and he had convulsions in the middle of the night and died. And she just grabbed him and went outside, walking around through the trees. And she said it was like the Lord said to her, it's all right, it's all right. And she couldn't understand why, but she said only the Lord knew there were 5 more peaches on the tree.
Now, talking of your brothers, you had 4 brothers, as you said, and you had lots of male cousins, a very male world in some way that you were brought up in. How did the male world affect you, do you think?
I think it was lovely because I understand men. I understand boys. They can cry. They can have the same feelings that women do. And the women that make a big fuss and carry on and cry a lot bore me to tears because I was raised with boys, you know.
Do you think then that there isn't much difference between men and women, obviously physically, but in terms of their
emotionally, there is a difference, but no, I'm definitely not a feminist.
Why?
Because I think there's a wonderful place for men and there's a wonderful place for women. And I see absolutely no reason at all why they should try to be the
same. But you believe in the equality of men and
women? Yes, yeah. I do.
And you could say that's what feminism's about.
Yes, in that way, but feminism is a great deal more than that. It's nonsense, most of it.
But I'm surprised to hear that you say that the man should still be the head of the house.
Somebody has to be, and I think a man doesn't get quite as mushy as a lady.
You obviously had fame and fortune, but you had, of course, some very difficult things happening in your life. Has your religious faith taught you that life is, as it says in the Bible, a valley of tears, a place of struggle and sorrow, or is life more joyful?
Sometimes it is, and sometimes it's the top of the mountain, you know.
How often is it the top of the mountain for you?
Oh, often. Most of the time.
Every day?
The valley of tears are very, very few.
Thinking back to when you were about 19 or something like that, somebody sent your photograph to Howard Hughes and you went to a screen test. What happened when you looked up on the screen and saw yourself? What did you think?
I was shocked.
Why?
I don't know. It looked better than I thought it was going to. I was shocked.
You didn't know you were beautiful?
No.
In one of the last good films that you made, The Fuzzy Pink Nightgown, there's a scene at the beginning where you're sort of doing your makeup and everything, and you're saying something which made me think. You're saying, you know, I'm just an ordinary business girl selling a little funny, phony commodity called sex.
Underneath that iron glove of yours, there's nothing but a little old iron fist.
Oh, sure. When they were pushing me around, it was just good business. Just let me start dishing out a little action, and I'm tough and temperamental.
They say.
Let them say. I'm just a simple business girl. I sell a funny, phony little commodity called sex. And if the customers are hungry enough to buy it, I run my own factory in my own way.
It felt autobiographical. That felt like that was a real Jane Russell speaking there.
Well, I think that picture and Gentlemen Prefer Blondes are the closest to the real me. I felt the most natural doing them, you know.
Tell me what your character's like in Fuzzy Pink Nightgown.
Well, she was a movie star, but she's very down to earth and very practical and no nonsense and get right to the point.
She starts with blonde hair and frocks, and then she's kidnapped by Ralph Beaker.
Right.
And you take off your blonde wig and your posh frock and everything, and you get into jeans and a tied shirt at the front.
Right.
And is that you as well? Do you feel more comfortable now?
Oh, absolutely. I never dress up unless I'm going out.
And is that because
couldn't be bothered. My husband says he's going to get a grocery cart and take me down to the fig tree where the homeless people are and take a picture of me in the outfits I run around the house in because they're so awful.
Really? I said to your husband yesterday, are you going to come to the interview with Jane? And he said, I've heard all that bullshit before.
Right. Absolutely.
That's a healthy attitude he has to your celebrity.
Yes. And my brothers all had the same thing. Said, it's, here comes the movie star. Wonderful, you know. Thank you.
But you became instantly a movie star, Jane, and one of the most famous women in the world because of that film you screen tested for, The Outlaw.
Tell me about that, because its budget went from $500,000 to $3.5 million.
Oh, my word.
And it took ages to make, and there are stories of hundreds of takes for some shots.
Well, it's a good thing I had never made another picture. You know, I'd have been screaming all the way through that. We shot for 9 months, but I thought that's what they did. And Jack Butel was the same. We just thought that was normal.
This is Billy the Kid.
Howard Hughes was a genius as far as creating ideas, you know, and for instance, in the picture where Billy gets his ears shot out, Howard dreamed that up. But he would say, now, Jack, you raised your left eyebrow in that. Now, if you could just not do that this next time. And then with me, it was, you know, you had your shoulder up, and I'd rather you didn't do that. And so we try to, you know, and pretty soon we're, don't raise your eyebrow and don't raise your, but he was a very nice, kind man.
You get out of here and shut the door.
Why? Have you gone crazy?
Just get out of here. You can bring the minister here and feel better about it. Now get out. You're not gonna die. I'll get you warm.
But you see, the thing is, Jane, when you watch that, it's hard not to think of that story you tell in your autobiography where you were staying at Hughes's house on his birthday, I think. And you had to stay over for some complicated reason, and he was cold, and he asked to get into your bed.
Yeah.
And of course, we know that Hughes identified so much with Jack, who's playing Billy the Kid in this picture.
When I went down in the morning, I just said, you guys are trying to redo The Outlaw? What is this?
And he must have had this scene in his head, do you think?
He was very childlike.
And do you remember the cinematographer, Greg Toland? You know, who shot Citizen Kane and everything? He shot this one.
Yes, he did. And there is that one shot where she's leaning over the bed and there's too much neck, you know. And Greg said at the end of the shot, that's a bad angle, I've got to get over here and shoot it. But Howard used the first one.
Hmm. Greg had more taste.
Oh, yes, yeah. Of course.
And of course, after this film, you did loads of publicity and things like this, and you didn't really do anything for quite a while.
2 years of publicity.
Which is unbelievable.
And the picture hadn't come out.
Yeah, and you hadn't seen it?
No, hadn't seen it.
And you were unhappy with the publicity?
Well, I had been modeling before, but the photographer was a wonderful man who was very careful, and if a picture was wrong, he tore it up. You know, just never used anything. So when I was out on location with The Outlaw, and they had all these photographers, and they kept saying, lean down and pick this up, I didn't know what was going on. And when I saw them, that was the end of that.
Yeah. How long do you think Hughes was controlling your image from 1941 till when, would you say?
Well, actually, I guess it was until Fuzzy Pink Nightgown.
Until 1957?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So for 16
because
years.
Because I was always under contract to him. I never was under contract to anyone else.
Yeah.
I signed 3 different contracts.
In retrospect, do you think it was a good thing or a bad thing for you to have this single mentor, especially if he was controlling your imagery in some way?
Well, I wouldn't have signed the last contract with him if I hadn't thought it was all right, you know. Mm.
The next clip I've got is another Western, but a very different type of Western, where you play Calamity Jane, and it's a comedy.
It's almost like you're trying to repudiate the seriousness of this film or something.
I was playing Bob Waterfield in Pale Face. That was my husband, and yeah. They used to call him the Great Stone Face. He would make all these smart remarks with no expression whatsoever, you know, just...
And that deadpan worked nicely against Bob Hope's.
Bob Hope, yeah. And I thought I'd died and gone to heaven when I made Pale Face. They made it, you know, two takes were a lot.
Wait, I've been chased by women before, but not while I was awake.
I'll take over now.
Yeah, you drive a while. Who wants to watch the road?
I'm gonna join that wagon train. Come on!
Head them any way you like. What am I saying? That's Indian country out there.
Well, you're not afraid of a few Indians, are you?
Oh, it's not the Indians I'm afraid of. It's their attitudes. They're hatchet happy. I'm heading back home, Washington, D.C.
I'm gonna join that wagon train.
Yeah, you can't join them without a wagon. Make up your mind. Are you going with me?
You got yourself a traveling companion.
Keep traveling. Boy, can you kiss?
Sorry I had to do that, son. But this is a big job.
And you got good notices for this picture, unlike The Outlaw?
Oh, yeah, sure.
People say, yeah, this was the first sense that you had a real comic talent.
Well, I probably would have died if I hadn't been able to make this picture.
Why?
Well, I just mean, you know, career-wise, I would have died.
But you didn't die, of course, and you went on to work with Frank Sinatra and Groucho Marx in Double Dynamite, which I don't think was very good. And then there was His Kind of Woman, your first pairing with Robert Mitchum. Why did you love working with him?
I loved Robert Mitchum.
The first scene in the movies where Mitchum sees you, and he really sees you, he looks you up and down, but what's nice, you sort of look him up and down as well. You're singing that song, Five Little Miles from San Berdu. Do you remember that one?
He became one of my best friends, you know.
Five little miles from San Berdu, I woke up humming and thought of you. I looked out the window, what a view. Five little miles from San Berdu, 4 little miles from San Berdu. The porter shouted, we're almost due. I saw familiar spots we knew. 4 little miles from San Berdu, 3 little miles from San Berdu. My bag was packed and ready. I said to myself, steady. 2 more miles and you're in heaven. 1 little mile from San Berdu. My heart was skipping a beat or two. Oh, what a thrill when I saw you waiting at the station down in San Bernardino, man. Berdu.
That was swell.
Cantaste muy bonito, señorita.
Gracias, gracias. Your Spanish is pretty good, baby.
He ended up writing scenes. He would have been a wonderful writer. He told fabulous stories just on end, and it all went out in the air. I could kill him. You know, it should all be down in, on pages where people can read it, because he read and read and read, and then he would talk and talk and talk, but he didn't write and write and write.
Don't you dampen it first?
Oh, it's an old habit. Whenever I have nothing to do and I can't think, I always iron my money.
What are you doing? You're broke.
When I'm broke, I press my pants. You know, one time a dame walked into my room, just like you did right now. She'd been out in the rain. You know, I pressed her dress dry for her.
What did she do?
She went in the kitchen and poured me some coffee.
You didn't think you're the strangest man I ever knew.
What makes you think you know me?
What do you want me to do, leave?
I want you to go out and pour the coffee.
Now, His Kind of Woman was one of the first films of yours that was shot by Harry Wilde.
Yeah.
Now, he shot so much of your work.
Yeah.
In fact, you seem to have your own team of technicians.
Yeah.
Was that unusual?
Yes. And again, it was Howard Hughes that was, if it hadn't been him, I probably could never have done that. But he liked the way Harry photographed me, and he was very particular about that. And so he had Harry under contract, and then I had a crew. I would just pick one off this picture and one off that, people that could do things quickly, because I didn't like to take a lot of time and waste, you know, hours in the morning before work. So I ended up with my crew, and they were all under contract.
And even when you left RKO and went to Fox, for example, some of
these
people...
They all went with me.
Very unusual.
Yes.
Okay. 1951, you made a film called Macau. Do you remember it fondly?
Oh, yeah.
Yes, why?
Well, I mean, it was... I remember it because we had what you know his name. I can't remember.
The director?
Yeah.
Von Sternberg?
Von Sternberg, who had done Dietrich's stuff.
Yeah.
I don't know what he thought. I guess he hadn't made a picture for quite a while, but that was the only other director that I just... He would go to me and say something about Mitch. And then he would go to Mitch and say, now what are we going to do with this beautiful, stupid girl? And Mitch would go, And he was very nasty to the crew.
What was his purpose in that, though?
I don't know. He was just a difficult man. And you couldn't have a Coke on the set, no food, no drink, or anything like that. So Mitch had finally had it up to here, and we all had. We were like a big family. So Mitch came on and he brought a picnic basket and he took a blanket out and laid it in the middle of the set and put the basket down and pulled out a bottle of vodka and a bottle of a bunch of stuff and started handing things out and cookies and food. And Von Sternberg just, what are you doing? And he took Mitch aside and he said, you know, you could be put off this picture. And Mitch said, no, you can be put off this picture. We're sick of it. And he was put off. And then Nicholas Ray came on and Mitch wrote the scenes in the picture that are natural.
I've got this scene here where you're taking off a stocking and dropping it down. Do you remember when Mitch catches it as it drops along? Would that have been one that Mitch
Yes, would? Absolutely.
Enjoy the view?
Well, it's not the Taj Mahal or the Hanging Gardens of Babylon, but it's not bad.
Did anyone ever tell you what big blue eyes you have, Grandma?
My name's Trumbull, Mr. Why, she meet an old friend of mine, Miss...
Your old friend's name is Julie Benton, and thanks again, Mr. Trumbull.
I, of course, accept completely that Vern von Sternberg was impossible to work with, but I think you look more beautiful in this picture than any other. And when you look at Jet Pilot, a film that Janet Leigh made with him for Howard Hughes again, she looks more beautiful in that than any other time. So maybe he was a monster, but he had a way of making women look divine, as he did with Dietrich. Would you accept that?
Well, I still had all my crew, though, and I had...
Yeah, you had Harry.
You know, Michael Wolff was doing the clothes, and, you know...
I'm thinking now about 1951, you were turning 30. Already some things had happened in your life. You'd realized that you couldn't have children naturally, you and your first husband.
Right.
And what happened? How did you deal with that?
I just was raised in such huge families, you know, that I thought, well, it's as normal as children grow on trees. So we'll adopt. We'll find children. And I asked in the adoption agencies at home, and they had a big, long waiting list, and it would be 2 years, and I didn't want to wait 2 years. And then I had an independent adoption offered to me, and I was very nervous about it. It was a little girl, and she was born on my birthday. It was like a sign, she's yours. And I wanted her to have an older brother. So I started looking for a boy that was anywhere between 1 and 2 years old. I was coming to England to do a command performance for the Queen and the King, and I thought, well, I'll take my mom. I went to Italy, I went to France, I got into orphanages. But you had to be French, or you had to be Catholic, or you had to be whatever, you know, in each of these areas. And when I came back to England, the story had gotten out, and that's when I got the call from Flory Cavanaugh. And she said she had a little boy that was 15 months old, same age my son, my older brother had been when he died. And she brought him up and put him on the bed, and I could hardly look at him. He was so gorgeous. And that went along as smooth as can be. It wasn't until we got him back in the States that we found out how dare an American take a British subject out of the country. And we had a 9-month legal battle. But finally, the judge said that we had done the best thing for the child, and they allowed it to go. I had seen so many children, and I knew how many people were waiting at home. And I just thought, this is ridiculous. It isn't practical. It isn't a sensible thing. Children should be adopted if they can't be with their natural parents. So every time Howard Hughes wanted me for a personal appearance, I'd say, fine, I will go, but I want an open ticket, and don't ask me where I'm going. And they arranged it.
And where were you going?
I was going to Washington, D.C.
To see Eleanor Roosevelt?
Well, she's one of the people that I got to see, but first I went to the Children's Bureau, and then I went to the State Department. You know, the State Department wrote all kinds of letters and had them all sent back. There aren't any children available in these countries. And I said, garbage, I've seen them, you know. And then finally, a friend took me to the Ford Foundation, and they sent me to International Social Service. The head of that said, if you can raise the money, I'll hire the social workers, and we'll get the job done. 1955, we started it, and I retired last year after 40 years, and there were 41,000 children had been placed.
So you were doing this work, but it sounds as if there were problems in your first marriage at this stage. You came from a family that was proud that there were no divorces in the family,
yes,
but eventually you would divorce your first husband.
Well, it was after 23 years.
Yeah. And was he violent to you?
No. No. It was just, it got impossible.
In 1953, you go to Fox. You're a big star. You bring your team with you. You're teamed up with a sort of unknown blonde girl called Marilyn Monroe,
yeah,
to make a film, Gentlemen, yeah, Prefer Blondes.
Yeah.
It's understandable and obvious why men loved you in the films because of your beauty. But it's also interesting, my mom said to me, you know, your dad loved Jane Russell, but I loved her too. And women liked you in very much in your films, particularly in Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, I think. And it's something to do that, like the scene
we
I've got here.
Buddies.
Yeah, that kind of buddy protectiveness. Yeah. And there's Just Two Little Girls from Little Rock, the opening song. When Monroe's doing her bits, there's this look on your face of absolute, like, sisterliness, which
yeah,
is so sweet and so charming. Let's just have a wee look at that.
Then someone broke my heart in Little Rock, so I up and left the pieces there. Like a little lost lamb I roamed about. I came to New York and I found out that men are the same way everywhere. I was young and determined to be wine and dine and Herman, and I worked at it all around the clock. Now
she was something else. She was adorable. But she would get her feelings hurt. Now, this is what we were talking about earlier, girls. The one that was playing her boyfriend, after their first kiss, somebody asked him, what was it like? And he says, I felt like I was being swallowed whole, you know. Well, she overheard that, and she burst into tears and went running into the dressing room and closed the door, and it took forever to get her out. Now, that's ridiculous. You know, I would just say, you'd be so lucky, honey. But that's what I mean about girls.
That they're sort of.
See, Marilyn was not raised around boys.
Yeah. That's why she needed you, the girl on the team, to sort of make her feel part of it all.
There's a big difference if girls have been raised around boys or if they haven't. And the same with boys. Mm. Howard Hughes was never raised around
girls.
Uh-huh. See?
That explains the way
he didn't understand
girls in such
and
a
distance. Yeah, he saw them in a totally different way, and it was just ridiculous. Mm-hmm. Marilyn had never had a dressing room before, so they gave her her first dressing room, and she was afraid to come out on the set. She would get there much earlier than I did. I would get completely dressed in an hour, and other actresses would come in anywhere from 5:30 on, and you had to be on the set at 9 o'clock. I would come in at 8, and they would have my breakfast ready, and they would be rolling my hair dry, I was on the set at 9. Well, Marilyn wasn't there, and she'd been in since 5 or 5:30. So her makeup man told my makeup man, Shotgun, that Marilyn was just nervous about coming out. He says, she's all ready, but she just, you know. And Howard Hughes was getting a little irritated.
Hawks.
And so I would go by her dressing room, and I'd say, come on, Blondie, let's go. You know, it's almost time. And she'd, oh, okay, all right. And she'd get up, and we'd trot on the set. And she was never late. She didn't know anybody out there. Yeah. And she was working with someone that had made a whole bunch of pictures, you know. And my crew and I were family. And Shotgun was a crazy Texan. He was a darling. He was a makeup man. He would be out on the set, and I'd stick my head out and say, shot! And he'd say, oh, oh, I'm coming, madam, I'm coming, madam. And he'd come running across, you know. And the others were all looking like this. What in God, she must be a real bitch. What's she like? And he'd come in and close the door, and we'd both laugh and scream and hug each other.
Howard Hawks, the director, says that sometimes he would give you direction and then you would sort of translate it for her, and then she would say, oh, right, I can do that. It's almost as if you were his go-between. Is that true?
Well, we were friendly. We were very friendly. And I felt like she was a little sister, you know, that you could help along. And the thing was, she had a coach on the set. And instead of looking to the director after a take to see if it was okay, she would look to her coach. Mm. You don't do that with Howard Hawks, honey. So he put the coach off the lot.
Howard Hawks also said that he didn't direct the musical numbers. It was Jack Cole, the choreographer.
Absolutely.
He did put the blame on Mame with Rita Hayworth and yeah. Some Like It
right,
happening.
Right.
Yeah.
Nobody directed Jack Cole but Jack Cole, and he was wonderful. We started out, Marilyn and I started out learning the dance routines first, and Marilyn would have been with her coach the night before, and she'd come in to do the dance rehearsals, because neither one of us were dancers. And then after, I'd say, Jack, I'm not learning, you know, and he'd say, go, baby, go, it's fine. And then Marilyn would stay for another hour.
I've got here, Jean, probably your most famous scene in the cinema, which is the Anyone Here for Love scene in the same film with you and the Olympic team.
Oh, yeah. My brother's in it.
I know you touch his hair, don't you?
Yeah.
And also at the very end of this scene when you're pulled into the water.
Yeah.
That was what, not planned?
No, it wasn't planned. And they let the poor dancer go that did it. And then we had to come back. That was on a Friday. And we had to wait all weekend and come back and reshoot the thing on Monday. And then without my going into the pool, which is ridiculous, because I was sure they were going to use the one in the pool, and they did.
Doesn't anyone want to play? I like big muscles and red corpuscles. I like a beautiful hunk of man, but I'm no physical culture fan. Ain't there anyone here for love, sweet love?
That was my brother.
Ain't there anyone? Ain't there anyone?
Great scene. It's this scene that makes you so much liked by gay audiences, you know, because it's a sort of very camp, very gay scene as well, that one. The next clip I've got is one you're on. It's from a film called French Line. You play a rich Texan who's very happy in jeans and a plaid shirt.
Yeah, yeah.
She wants to sort of...
Well, somebody's told her that all these guys are after her money, so she's going to find somebody that's just for her and not after her money.
Yeah. Now, the famous scene is the dance scene Looking for Trouble.
Oh, yeah.
Remember that?
Yes.
And they wanted you to wear a very skimpy bikini or something.
Yes. And there were no bikinis in America at the time. Only the naughty girls in the south of France wore bikinis. And Howard Hughes thought I was going to wear a bikini. So I went to the beach and stayed there for about a week. You know, and just said, no, I'm not going to wear a bikini. Mm.
And so they came up with a less revealing outfit. And it's a very raunchy song. Are you happy with the scene, or do you think it's vulgar in some way? There are some of these shots looking right into your breasts and everything. And the film was in 3D, which emphasized that. Do you think they were vulgarly shot?
It didn't bother me.
And when some of your films, like Outlaw, were denounced by some of the church and everything?
Yeah, I was bothered about a lot of the publicity pictures that they were using.
Okay, let's have a look at this number. It's extraordinary, I think.
Gonna rock all the rafters, do it upright. I'm gonna raise a little Fahrenheit. I'll melt all the snow in Alaska till it steams like the tropical Amazon. I'm gonna pop all the corn in Nebraska. If he's shy, it's goodbye. If he's brave, bring him on. I'm looking for trouble. I'm gonna throw the book away. Be unpredictable from day to day in every way I can. So this Cinderella is looking for a fella who'll tell her what she's sweet as I am. Looking for trouble, won't mind the trouble if trouble looks like a man.
Of course, then he picked her up and threw her over his shoulder and walked out of the place with her, and they got married and lived happily ever after.
Yeah. And around about this time, you decided to get your own production company.
It was about the time that studios were falling down more, and people were getting their own production companies. MCA was my agent at the time, and they felt we should have our own company. So we did. And I wanted to have half control, you know. I could go and do a nightclub if I wanted to go and sing, I could do things on the side, which I had never been able to do.
You did a Western called The Tall Men, directed by Ryle Walsh. Mm-hmm. A magnificent Western and somewhat undervalued, I think.
He was the most sensitive, wonderful director.
But another very masculine director. You didn't work, as you say in your book, you didn't work with Cukor or any of the
No, I never got directors. To work with a woman's director. I worked with all men's directors.
And that's a regret?
Well, I don't know. I never got to know. I didn't know. You know, it would have been interesting to see what would have happened.
In 1956, you did a film by one of my favorite directors, Nicholas Ray, who had already done some work on Macau, as we talked about.
Yes, I was very, very tired when I was making that film. It was the third in a row without stopping, so I didn't have as much fun with Nick as I probably would have.
And he had just come off Rebel Without a Cause.
Husband, here's your wine.
And again, you had a production role in that film.
But he wanted me to go and look at the scene, you know, the next scene, and I'd say, Nick, all I want to do is go and lie down, you know. Why don't you take care of that?
One of the last clips I've got here, Jane, is from The Revolt of Mamie Stover, again directed by Walsh, is that right?
I'm trying to even remember these movies.
Right. Well, I'll tell you, it's the one where you have red hair and you play a prostitute and you're ejected from
something. It was Raoul and Richard Egan.
Oh, yeah. Yes, he's the
wonderful, wonderful, sweet guy. Yeah.
Now, you were saying in the car as we were talking that you're not a feminist, but this is a kind of feminist film, isn't it? It's a film about a woman's desire for emancipation. She's a prostitute and she hasn't been treated the same as anybody else. And
in the picture, she's supposed to just be a dancing lady.
Yeah, but they toned it down.
Oh, God. Well, yeah.
Did you want it more gritty? More realistic?
No, I probably wouldn't have done it. Mamie had a tough life.
And the scene I've got here is that she's talking about money can buy you anything.
Yeah, she's all for money.
She's all for money. Do you feel she's bad in this film for being all for money? Or
she ruins her life.
Yeah, but she gives her money away.
Well, yes, they fixed that because in the book she didn't. She ended up in a grand house and alone.
What do you want to see me about? I'm due at the country club.
Miss Hilltop?
I don't like that name.
I didn't mean it that way. I wish I could trade places with her. You know, there's different rights for different people. There's all kinds of don'ts for me. And not a single don't up here on the hilltop.
Oh, there's lots of them. On every hilltop in the world.
Not the kind that keep you from breathing.
You could breathe back in Leesburg. I'm holding a lot of money for you, Mamie. Take it and go home in style. Make the biggest splash in the town's history. Settle down there with the same rights as everyone else. If you stay here, even if you make $1 million, you still have to live with those don'ts.
Not me. I'm going to break every single one of them wide open. I'm going to live in a house just like this. Maybe even bigger. You just wait and see. Jimmy, with enough money, you can buy anything.
See, I took this as different. You're saying there have been so many don'ts in my life. Don't do this, don't do that. Because she was a prostitute, a fallen woman. And she's saying, but I want to take control of my own life.
Well, it's funny. I asked the writer, I said, would you like your daughter to be a prostitute? And he said, I think that might be one of the most interesting jobs a woman could have. I thought, you jackass, I'm certainly glad you're not my father. Does that answer your question?
It does,
honey.
This is towards the end of the 1950s now. You didn't do many more great pictures after I Think This Is Very Good and Fuzzy Pink Nightgown.
No.
What happened? Did offers stop coming or did you draw back or something?
Well, I did sign that third contract with Hughes and they didn't come up with anything. Howard was starting to remove himself from the business. I started doing plays, and I had never done plays before, you know, and met Roger Barrett, and I married Roger about 3 months later, and 3 months after that, he died of a massive coronary.
at the age of like 47 or
47 so. Years old. The same age my father was when he died. And I was devastated.
Yeah.
Devastated.
And you drank heavily.
Yeah.
And did your daughter try to commit suicide in the 60s?
Yeah.
It sounds like a terrible
point
in your career.
Well, it was probably the divorce and all of that and that caused Tracy. And she has had depression in her life. Serious depression. She has to take medication for it, but she's wonderful now.
Yeah. And then you met your third husband.
Yeah, it was about 6 years, and I think John found me. As my cousin says, he's the best thing that ever happened to her.
We've already said that your character in Fuzzy Pink Nightgown is one of the closest to you, and I wanted to end on a scene from Fuzzy Pink Nightgown.
Oh, good.
When we first saw you at the beginning of the film, you've got your blonde and everything on, and now you're in your ordinary clothes, and it's a scene with Ralph Meeker, which is rather nice. And I think, again, what you're saying seems to be quite personal to you, I think. Let's have a wee look at it, Jane.
But you weren't far wrong, Professor. That splendid career of mine does leave a few things to be desired.
You know why we picked you for this?
Just lucky, I guess.
No. I'd seen you before. Well, not really you. I mean, pictures of you in magazines and things, and some of your movies. And the way you walked, the way you filled a dress, like you were made for guys to go crazy over. So I just went crazy.
Anyway, it wasn't the flavor you expected. Silver hair was a phony.
I like this better.
To discover that you are so much more than make-believe. It's been an absolute pleasure talking to you. A real thrill. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you, Mark. I've enjoyed it.
It's 2:45. There's no one in the place except you and me. So set them up, Joe. I got a little story you ought to know. We're drinking, my friend, to the end of a brief episode. Make it one for my baby, one more for the road.
That's what I like doing the best, is singing.
I'm feeling so bad. I hope you make the music dreamy and sad. Could tell you a lot, but you've gotta be true to your code. Make it one for my baby, one more for
sadly, since the recording of this interview, Jane Russell's husband, John Peoples, has died.